today, folks, in full clarity on my path to financial independence, to perhaps one day retire early, as I liquidated six figures in ETFs out of my retirement accounts this morning. And I'm going to show you what those accounts actually look like as it stands in this moment, as I give full clerical view into my $450,000 dividend stock portfolio as a Canadian from a Canadian perspective. But we got to take the veil off and look at what's going on in the market here, because outside of things dropping, my God, we got billionaires. If it's not submarines sinking to the bottom of the freaking ocean and imploding on themselves, it's billionaires like Elon Musk and Mark Zuckerberg with two competitive companies, Instagram versus Twitter, ready to do a cage fight. I'm gonna give you my opinions on that. We're gonna talk about some Canadian REITs. So many of you had really in-depth opinions on that. I appreciate leaving those comments down below. We'll talk about weather patterns, making bets on those weather patterns. Canada's on fire, China's heating up, baby. There's a lot going on this week as always. So consider hitting that like button, because taking a broad view of the markets, first and foremost, we got pretty much all the major indices down today. And I try not to get excited when I sell and the markets go down, because I don't know what they're going to do. And that's the thing when you want to buy real estate, right? You want the liquid funds. You don't want to be making gambling bets in the next month on what's going to happen with the market. So that's what I did. And again, we'll look at my retirement accounts, my corporate account. I'll give you some clerical view on all of that. But yeah, the indices mainly sold off into the afternoon with a few exceptions in some of the tech companies. But again, most of them trading down. It's just been this continual breath after this wicked rally, which is well needed. And if you can't respect it in the market, you're going to go broke. Can't be chasing these crazy rallies. I said that, mentioned it. I mean, Palantir is now down in the 13s. Who guessed that? Oh, maybe this guy here, you know, just from experience in the market. I'm just telling you guys. But putting that aside, take a look at this. Zuckerberg replied to Elon Musk. And I think, you know, the age difference when we're talking about these two fighting it, and maybe I should give you guys some backstory on this first. What really caused this? To be honest, I don't entirely know. But if you read into it, you know, I guess some people were joking about him fighting Mark Zuckerberg. He said, I'm up for a cage match. If he is, lol, laugh out loud. And he's a meme machine. I don't know the reality of him actually considering doing this, but in the world of all these influencers on YouTube, your Jake Pauls, your Logan Pauls of the world, making more money at their cage fights than the traditional, the traditional world of fighting and MMA or whatever, it's kind of mind-blowing and something that might not even be out of the realm of possibility. But on Wednesday evening, Zuckerberg responded on his own platform on Instagram by posting a story which included a screenshot of a tweet that was made by Elon Musk, and he said, send me the location, at which Elon actually replied, outside of him saying, I have this great move that I call the walrus, where I just lie on top of the opponent and do nothing, which honestly I don't think bodes well in any, you know, cage match here. You know, he did say that he'd do it at the Vegas Octagon. If that's true, if that's awesomely going to become a reality, oh my God, I'd make every bet. I would take out gambling. Whoever's doing it, I'm betting on Mark Zuckerberg. I mean, this guy actually owns like a $100 million property in Hawaii. He's out there on surfing every damn day. He's got a nice juicy behind from doing that. Remember those memes? Anyways, the dude, I think Mark's got a little bit more oomph behind him, not knocking women up and sleeping in factories all day like Elon does. And I got no disrespect against Elon. I just think this would be a laughable fight. But who knows? Maybe he'd train for it. Maybe he'd get into shape. What does it mean for the stocks? Meta's been on an utter tear. This thing does not take a breath. It's currently hitting, you know, its 52-week highs. It's crushing it. The last 5 days alone, this thing is flat, but I mean, it is up 1%. I sold out of this thing around 220 last year, right around the first quarter on this little bump here, thinking that I was doing myself a favor. My fiance got more fortitude than I do in this market. Her average cost was during the pandemic area, where she got in at around 170, and she rode this thing all the way down, and now she's crushing the returns on this. And I got to give her a lot of respect, because I didn't have the fortitude to ride that. So my fiance, women, they sometimes are just better at investors. You know, they say women are emotional, but they seem to be more stable emotionally when it comes to investing. What does it mean for these two stocks though? Tesla, you think if Elon lost, Tesla stock would drop? I don't know if it would reflect on the stock prices as much as it might their own personal egos, in my opinion. But I'd love to know what you think in the comments section below. But where I have more respect for Tesla, more than I ever did in the past, has to do with the BS that we've talked about this week coming out of China with these EVs from Baidu. They're bullshitting their numbers. They're saying they're selling more than they actually were thanks to ride-sharing programs, or so it's speculated. And now they're just piling up as junk with no use cases on them. And these were sold cars that have license plates. This is something that I think is utterly concerning, that the market might be undervaluing in the race to actually like good EV companies growing. And now that we're getting all these partnerships with the charging networks, you can just see this future coming in the next 10 or 20 years, how much, again, thinking a lot of this on the car side is valued into the stock. Again, if self-driving or any of that come into play, you don't know where Tesla could go. It's an impossible company to value, but you can't help but recognize the future that is slowly becoming of this company's impact on the auto industry. Now, when it comes to Chinese companies, I've given up on these. I don't want anything to do with them anymore because, again, I thought I had some faith in BABA. I bought some a while ago, sold out of it, and I just don't think this thing will have a leg to stand on because you can just never trust the numbers when all these other companies are able to manipulate their books and get these crazy stock rallies because a lot of them just want to bring foreign investment dollars, and I'm sure the political landscape kind of supports it to some extent. You know, even Charlie Munger made comments that he doesn't want anything to do with BABA because he thought there was more to the company than there actually was based on some of the IPO with Ant Group, which all of that's kind of just severing and getting convoluted, and you don't know what is real. My opinion, I still like BABA from a value standpoint, but you're making the risk and you're taking this value play as that risk that's baked into the current price. But that doesn't mean there isn't interesting plays to do around China. Beijing soars above 41 degrees Celsius. We're talking about weather patterns that haven't been seen for 100 plus years, literally globally, and it is devastating to a lot of aspects of China. And I was watching Dumb Money. They pointed out some really interesting trades that will make a lot of money off this. Undoubtedly, without BSing the books, and this has to do with HVACs. You know, we're talking about, like, this one's a heating and ventilation company here. We're talking about Carrier Global. And this thing has been rallying on the anticipation that this heat wave's probably not going away. People are going to need more ventilation, air conditioning. And it's just, and this, these stocks aren't trading at wicked premiums. And this is one that has actually done very well since its IPO price. If anything, if you want to make those kind of trades, these are things I'd be looking into, and I really recommend watching Dumb Money. They did a great job explaining things like Generac and talking about, you know, the potential trades on these. And again, I think as the market crashed, these could even be good value plays if you want to make those kind of swing bets on the current macro situations. Again, not financial advice, a lot more speculative in nature, as even Canada's on fire. And honestly, if you were making adverse trades, short trades, I've talked to a lot of mining companies in Canada, and you got to be a little careful with this year specifically. With Canada on fire, especially Quebec, I think there's, what, over 400 fires or something. A new one was just announced Monday. People have stopped talking about this, but a lot of the mining companies, the Quebec government said, hey, and Quebec is a major mining area, that there is no more drilling allowed for this year, and this is their prime drilling season. You know, the frost is gone, the ice and snow is gone, they set everything up, and they can't do anything because the government's halted all of it. This is also concerning trades for, I'm sure, a multitude of, not environmentally, but forestry-based companies, and something to look into if you're more on the swing trade, something that I'll probably bring up in future videos, so consider subscribing for that. Now, last time I showed you, my portfolio was around 450. It has pulled back. This doesn't accurately represent the trades that I did this morning. I'm going to update this for my next video. And again, I'm just sitting on this lingering edge right now. We're finishing up our mortgage approvals. We're kind of just looking right now. We've already looked at a few properties per se, and we just want to be in the position that say, hey, you know, if something comes up in the next few months that we like, we need to be able to make an offer on it, and I need that liquid cash, and it's something prudent when it comes to actually getting the mortgage approval and everything done. So what I went ahead and did, yes, I know it's crazy. It even feels crazy to me, and not that I'm going to even use all of this cash. I'm going to debate on how much I want to use, because again, I'm not going to get into my fiance's finances, but we're in a pretty healthy position for a much more substantial down payment to not take the winded edge of these high interest rates. And now that the market in Canada is cooled, it's still moving, but it's cooled, we're in this place where I can make reasonable offers and have a likelihood of closing it. And I don't feel like there's going to be a much better opportunity to get in the market when there is a bit of struggle going on. So I've got about 165,000. My TFSA's all-time peak high was around 180. So since the market pulled back last year, things have been flatlined. I was up on the S&P, down a little bit on VDY. I figured now, just because it's at this nice nominal area where it's up a bit from the lows, I don't really care that from the all-time high, I'm taking a $20,000-$25,000 loss. I don't need to rush back and make gambly bets to try and get my peak performance percentage gain back to where it was, because I've already made returns in this account that go so far above the S&P 500 that, you know, to lock it into a piece of real estate where I can comfortably live and then start refueling this, it would make me a little bit more settled to not have to worry about the macro environment. Same with my RSP. I can only withdraw for a first-time home purchase about $35,000, right? So that is exactly what I liquidated out of SCHD. And again, it's down more than it was this morning. So I did end up getting out at a little bit better of a price today, which was nice. Not again that I care. I'm not really worried about the short-term fluctuations, as I'm going to continue to look to buy these back at some point. But yeah, I want to make sure this is accessible as well to me. Now, outside of these two accounts, my corporate account, until I start adjusting that, I'm not going to give too much clerical view. I didn't hardly sell any companies. In there, I have an S&P 500 index that I've got about $55,000 to $60,000 invested in. It's up pretty substantially from where I was buying the lows. Same within the Canadian side of the markets with VDY. That one I was down about 10% on, but I did collect some pretty decent dividends. I've got about $55,000 in VDY that I have not sold out of yet. So I have over 100 $100,000 still invested within the corporate account. However, I do have a lot of cash in that corporation, and I am going to be pulling some of it out, as my corporation owes me $35,000 tax-free from when I started it, which is great because that's what money that I put into it to get everything running and rocking. I'm lucky enough to finish up my corporate taxes that had the year end of March, and I'm going to owe like maybe $5,000 or $6,000, so I have some clerical view on exactly what I can and can't pull out of there in a tax-efficient manner. I will have a liquid access to about $300,000, again, discluding what my fiancé is doing. You know, that gives us so much leeway into this real estate market. Again, we are not looking for million-dollar properties. We are frugal. I do want to have the opportunity to financially retire, maybe even have the option to have kids at some point. So where location doesn't matter. We can drive, we can do whatever it takes just to get into a market that isn't as heated as it was, right? We'll come back. I'll talk about the real estate in a moment. If you want updates as that evolves more clerically and more in-depthly, again, we're just finishing up some of the approvals, the mortgage stuff, and I'll do some specific videos on even what we're looking at, but consider subscribing for those updates. I'll come back to the conversation with some comments in a moment, but in the corporate account side of things, as mentioned, I'm not done selling VDY. I haven't taken any real loss on it, even though it has been trending down, again, thanks to the dividends, but I do want further exposure primarily to the financial sector. I think it's underappreciated. It's one of the best growth sectors Canada's ever had. They're monopolistic in their behavior, and they've had just the most stable and reasonable growth, and now they're at a place where people think they're going to collapse. They think mortgages are going to collapse. As much as I'd like that to happen, this isn't financial advice, I just don't think it will, and there's some stocks here that have been unfavorably, you know, getting slaughtered because of certain deals that couldn't close. And you said, like, what are you looking at? RY, TD, BNS? I think like Pokemon cards, you can collect them all, but I want to get the best return out of them. And I think what's going to happen is once we get through loan loss provisions, once the market stabilizes, the companies like Royal Bank that are having the best acquisition growth with customers have the best revenue growth, that is inevitably going to hit the bottom line. And in a higher interest rate environment, it only does juicier and better for them. So, I mean, you take a look at this and it's trading down what? I mean, we're talking about maybe 15-20% off its all-time highs, which is wonderful considering the revenue is actually at an all-time high. So Royal Bank's on the list. I'm not dividend dependent here. I don't care about high dividends. Again, I'm looking for total return. So Royal Bank, and is also Canada's largest company, monopolistic in their behavior. I love it. Now, Royal Bank is probably going to close on the deal with HSBC, the Canadian counterpart of it. And Royal Bank is primarily Canadian-focused bank. So I think they're going to get the best growth considering Canada just hit 40 million people and continues to see a lot of influx from immigration. So I think they're going to do fine from a growth standpoint. TD's got that US exposure, which does hinder them a little bit. If they could have got that deal closed with First Horizon, it would have made them one of the 10 largest banks in the US. And because they couldn't close that deal, people unjustly, I think, slaughtered the stock, and it's down again 15-20% here. Over the last year. From the peak, however, it's down what, like 27%, paying almost a 5% yield, and again, with still revenues hitting record levels. I think that's TD's a great stock, also Canada's second largest company. The third bank, and probably unsurprisingly, is Canadian Imperial. I honestly think these banks are like Pokemon cards. You can just justifyingly collect them all, but as somebody that does like to see better returns, I am just looking for these specific catalysts that I think are going to come into play, and I do like Canadian Imperial over, say, Bank of Nova Scotia. BMO is seeing a big revenue flux right now. National Bank's pretty good from a growth perspective. It's smaller, it's seen more growth, but the revenues are kind of flatlining into the last quarter anyways. I'm kind of hindering between National Bank and Canadian Imperial because Canadian Imperial over the long term hasn't seen the same kind of growth, unfortunately, but again, I think down here at the level it's trading at is unjust. It's down 34%, 6% dividend yield, I think because it's largely exposed to a lot of mortgages. But again, you look at the last quarter and you're talking about a lot of green, a lot of good revenue growth outside of some of the other banks. So these are things that I am considering. You read the news, there's a lot of concerning news. It's things that I'm still looking into just to make sure, because again, banks aren't in like my wheelhouse of expertise. I just, again, they're Canadian, world renowned for reasons that I just don't think should be overlooked when they're trading down this much specifically, considering how well they came out of the recession of 2008. You know, we didn't see any major defaults in our banks like the US did, right? But putting that aside, you did ask me, you know, one of you saying, are you buying your personal residence or an investment property? Strongly suggest you find something with a rental unit attached because it's so powerful in the long run. Honestly, if you live in Canada, Ontario specifically, it is impossible. If we were in Alberta, I'd agree, but we can't. I mean, we're barely looking for two-bed condos within a price range that seems insane to all of my friends that live in the U.S. or Alberta. Like, it's just nuts. So, yeah, that's out of the question, unfortunately. So we're just going to keep it within a realm of possibility to have little to no mortgage. But as for stocks I bought, you bought a bunch of Allied properties. And I think a lot of the office space REITs will struggle, especially if they have weak balance sheets. I like Allied because they have a great balance sheet, and the most of their properties are in high-grade markets. Lots of cool downtown buildings in popular cities. And someone else commented on this as well, saying, you know, insane about Allied properties today. As you said, the reason today, I think, was that it sold up. Basically, one of the reasons it dropped was they sold about $1 billion to a Japanese company, which was part of their data centers. And it seemed like a good idea, as they made profit and will have extra cushion now and can actually pay down the debt with the $1.35 billion. I have no clue why the market didn't like that move. Maybe a better insight. I didn't hear you reading about it. And a lot of you kind of continued the conversation. And I do agree that I could never wrap my head around this stock. I've wanted to buy it. I've been intrigued to buy it. And I just haven't been able to pull the plug because I just want to wait for the next earnings to get an idea of what is going on with this company. I mean, if we take a look at the dividend as it stands today, which I think is listed on Yahoo, it's what, 8.4%. They can absolutely afford the dividend. I'm not sure about the deal with the data centers because it seemed like a value part of their properties. It's probably a little more sustainable. So I'm going to have to read into it. But the good thing about that deal is, if you didn't read into it, is that the sale will result in a significant increase in taxable income for fiscal 2023. Requiring Allied to declare and pay a special distribution to all unit holders that are recorded as at December 31st, 2023. So they're going to be paying out a huge dividend because of that income that they're generating from that sale. And they're going to be paying down more debt, which honestly, this isn't a company that was riddled with debt. This is a company that's seen their rental revenue continue to grow over the last year-over-year quarter by 14%. If we actually scroll down and just take a look at their funds from operation, they actually grew by 5%, which is astounding. And, you know, REITs pay out the vast majority of their income, but the payout ratios haven't been anything extreme based on the increases in interest rates or anything like that. I mean, if you just take a look at their total assets, you're talking about $11.9 billion in assets. Again, as of the last quarter, with only $4.3 billion in debt. And now they have another, what, $1.5 billion after taxes? Who knows? Maybe they'll pay this down by another $500 million to $1 billion. Like, from a debt to asset ratio, this is unusual. I mean, indebtedness ratio is 36%. There's not many REITs that have that kind of structure. So I don't know what I'm missing here. It's either one of the most unjustifiable drops in a REIT that I've seen in a very long time, or there's something going on that we're just not seeing. But what a week, baby. I'll pass the question off to you. I'd love to know what you think in that comment section below.